Welcome back, friends, to Eat, Read, Sleep, where we come together as a community to vibe with books. My name is Kalina, and I have my lovely co-host here.
Tapas, how's it going, guys? Welcome back.
And this week, we are kicking it off with a very controversial, very popular book, Sapiens, A Brief History of Humankind by Yuval Noah Harari.
Yes, so this book was, I don't know what you thought about it, Kalina, but I enjoyed it very much. I love history. I also like the underlying tone, but it is very controversial. I did see a lot of positive and negative reviews on this one. So I'd love to see where you land on this one too.
I do love history books as well. And I think this is a really cool turn for us because we have been doing more motivational, inspirational leadership books. And so this is more about getting into the mindset of humans, how we operate. So I like that because it gives us a deeper understanding of what we have been talking about. What I will say is that I did not greatly enjoy this book for several reasons. You just mentioned it. It's a bit harsh in the tone in terms of assumptions. And there were some themes in there where if he couldn't prove it or say something, it was more of like bias and leaning towards one side and then assuming and then going towards something else. It was just kind of like, it didn't sit well with me for certain parts, but we can kind of go through that with you guys.
Can't wait. It'd be fun to debate this because I on the other hand, did like this book very much. I think it's because I do like the directness of the Yuval.
I like it. Yeah. I like the book.
Yeah.
But I didn't love it.
I know, exactly. But I remember you and I were talking a lot and we're like, oh, this part is so good. And you're like, really? Is that how you saw it? I'm like, I saw it this way. So can't wait to debate that with you. But let's first go through a quick, just how we're going to lay this out for everyone.
Sure.
And then we can go into the individual parts that we're going to debate.
All right. So I think Yuval starts off with just like the main three parts of history of how we got to where we are today with modern society. So he starts off with actually four then, the prehistoric, right? Mm-hmm. Pretty much talking about how before the cognitive revolution, we were all prehistoric and it's prehistory. So humans pretty much were no more significant than any other animals on the planet. And so because we had no actual impact on the environment and the world, then it made no difference that we were there. It wasn't until we hit the cognitive revolution where we started seeing some changes in terms of understanding different concepts and ideas that led us to advance up into the food chain. And then that goes into the second revolution of the agricultural revolution. Mm-hmm. And that kind of changed from making the humans, the foragers, to farmers, and then agriculturally, how we got to where we are in terms of food and our diet, lifestyle, territories, things like that. And then it goes into the fourth revolution, which is where we kind of are at today. That started about 500 years ago. And that's where the discovery of science and the understanding idea that we actually don't know everything and that maybe we should know and learn a little bit more to strive for the overall theme of the book, happiness.
Yes. Yeah. So,
which is kind of underlining.
It is. But, yeah. I mean, he starts pretty much from like evolution of humans and talk about how the happiness changed there. And you can see that tone just kind of carry out throughout the whole book. So I like how he did that
too. Absolutely. Okay. So let's kick it off.
Yes.
I do want to start talking about the prehistoric part because that was kind of interesting to me. I've never really thought about humankind in that way. What did you think about being told that humans at that time were insignificant, had no meaning, and therefore prehistorically we just were there?
Yeah, it makes sense because, you know, at that time, humans were in like the middle of the food chain, right? So we weren't the dominant species.
Yep.
We were kind of reliant. And I mean, when you think about just how humans were at the time, you know, a lot of the other species, their infants and the kids, like the babies, can pretty much become a small version of their parents right away. Whereas humans, you have to have like 9 months of development and it takes a long time. So you can see where that really kind of differentiated the humans and why we were not such a, we were actually such a weak species compared to the others, right?
Yeah.
So I like how he kind of said, this is where we started. You know, we kind of, what Drake says, started from the bottom, now we're here, right? So like, I did actually like that because it does kind of show that we were not the dominant species, but how quickly we evolved is how we became the dominant one.
So. It was very humbling to open up with that because he says in there, we assume that we are the only almighty species for all of time. And this kind of just like opens up with that big slap in the face of like, no, you're not. Like,
yeah.
understand where you come from.
Exactly. And then it also started with us, with the humans kind of migrating, right? That was a big thing that kind of led to this entire spark in evolution. If we had just stayed in Africa, we may not have lasted very long, but we kind of spread throughout. So that was amazing.
One thing I really liked here before it starts jumping into the cognitive revolution is talking about how you said humans advanced up the food chain. So we were in the middle. What happened that how did we advance to the top?
Obviously, making fire. Mm-hmm. That was a big thing for the humans was we were able to cook our food a lot quicker than regular chimpanzees. Like, was it about an hour is what it takes for a human to cook a food? Whereas for chimps, it takes about 5 hours to fully eat a meal. So
a raw
that was
meal,
overwhelming, yeah. Right? Mm-hmm. And then, so that kind of helped with getting the nutrients quicker. It also evolved our brains because we were able to get everything processed quickly in our brains. And it also kind of made us more aware of the environment and make us more, like, I guess, smarter in that aspect, right? Be more strategic about how we hunt and stuff.
Well, technically, because then our brains got larger as well through that process. I thought it was really cool because he mentions how for animals, it takes millions of years for them to advance up to the top of the food chain. For lions to get up to the top, it takes millions of years because it requires a checks and balance in the ecosystem where gazelles need to learn how to run faster so that they can survive, so that their entire species doesn't get extinct. And there's just all these little things that need to happen with other species and within the ecosystem. Mm-hmm. And then enter humans, and not specifically Homo sapiens at the time, but just humans in general. They come in, they make fire, they start doing all of these progressive things that are way more advanced than the ecosystem is able to sustain. And because we've leaped millions of years, in essence, we've gotten to a place where our ecosystem and where we are as humans are not compatible. Like, where we are sitting right now, it's not natural. And he says, this is why people have fear. This is why we have nervousness and anxiety. Mm-hmm. It's because we're in a place that we're technically not supposed to be. And so biologically, our body knows that.
He kind of mentioned in the book too, like, humans kind of evolved a little too quickly. Like, our environment wasn't ready for it, and neither were we. Like, if you know, he says that humans first appeared around 2 million years ago, and then the first fire was lit 200,000 years ago. So in all that time, almost 1.8 million years, not much of a progression was made.
Yeah.
And then once the first fire was lit, and then you saw the evolution just kind of spike up. So within the next 100,000 years, we became Homo sapiens, and it just kind of, like, catapulted us straight to the top. So it's crazy that it took that much time for us to evolve, but at the same time, like, we did kind of spike up really, really quickly.
So you said the word Homo sapiens. Mm-hmm. So let's jump into that.
Yes.
That's a bit of a controversial right there. He talks about two theories, the replacement theory and the, what was the other one?
Like,
the
Interbreeding
theory. Yep. Yes.
So which one do you buy? So first one, we're going to go right into it. So interbreeding theory says that we breed it with other like Neanderthals or the erectus, and that's how we became where we are today. So
let's,
that combination of Homo sapiens plus.
Can we back up real quick? So let's kind of explain that a little bit. So Harari says that humans, within the entire human family, I think it separates up to different species. Mm-hmm. So there's humans does not mean just Homo sapiens. Right. There's Homo erectus, Homo neanderthalis, all these different species of humans. Homo sapiens is just one type of human.
Right.
So knowing that there's five or six other species at least, the interbreeding theory then is that the different species combined, were able to breed, create different species, and essentially we are who we are today because of that interbreeding of different species.
And then the replacement one is pretty much we overtook, or Homo sapiens overtook, the lands of Neanderthals and Homo erectus. And essentially, because they were there and we couldn't breed with them because they were a different species than us, that caused their extinction, because Homo sapiens are a lot more efficient, and they were also a lot more better at hunting, all that kind of stuff, and community versus Neanderthals and all of them. So we kind of eliminated or wiped out the entire population of the Homo erectus.
He leaves it there that it's either by indirect force or by direct force. And there's a very underlining, like, potential genocide type mentality.
Yes.
And that's why this theory, the replacement theory, is kind of touchy, because with that mindset, it also leads to thinking, okay, if we are a purebred, then those that are not purebred should therefore be eliminated as well. And it goes through talking about, like, he brings up like the Nazis and all of that. So it's uncharted territory I've never thought about.
Yeah.
What did you think about when we got there?
So for me, I'm on the side of Homo sapiens, the replacement theory. Homo sapiens wiped out the other species, right? Because the argument that Harari makes,
I feel like sometimes I see Neanderthals walking around. Just kidding.
Well, because Harari does say that if, let's say, hypothetically, because he also believes the replacement theory is what actually happened. But he says, let's say if there was interbreeding that happened. So does that mean that the Bible could only apply to the Neanderthals? Because they were essentially saying we have different humans around everywhere versus the same species but different cultures, right? So that's kind of how we evolved into. But that's kind of where I landed. I kind of bought into what Harari was saying. However, there is that new research that came out, I think, about a couple years ago, where they did find DNA of somebody that has 4% Neanderthal on them. So that could be another topic. Where did you land with that?
My initial gut is interbreeding. I feel like I shouldn't admit that out loud, but I do feel like there's a lot of differences among our species that should be recognized, and especially because of those recent findings and things like that. I think a lot of things are more swept under the rug and not wanting to talk about because it's just so like mind-blowing to find discoveries like this where there are Neanderthal DNA and how did that come about and things like that. So I do believe in the interbreeding.
I can see where interbreeding could make a good argument because of how different a lot of humans look from each other, like Asians versus Caucasians and Africans. Like, everyone looks different physically, right? I think that can also be a interbreeding because they said the Homo erectus went towards the Asian side. And so if we were to interbreed with them, that could be with my Asians, a lot of Asians.
So do you agree with me now?
No, because the Australian example he gave was very convincing towards the replacement theory, which essentially Homo sapiens made their way to Australia through the ice bridge, something like that, and essentially wiped out majority of the population, including other
large animals. All right, so now we've got Homo sapiens. We've got to a place where they've eradicated by force, indirect or not indirect, all the other species, and now Homo sapiens are the only ones left, essentially, in the cognitive revolution. What else happened in the cognitive revolution? They finally understood that there's the ability to storytell and understanding of myths and things that they didn't believe in before because it wasn't tangible. He talked about the growth of the population, right? So in communities that are smaller, it's easier to cooperate and collaborate and get along. But as these communities got bigger, there was no longer a way to maintain order. So in order to maintain order in human communities greater than 150, that's when storytelling and beliefs and things like that had to come about so that there was a common bond to unite these people.
Yeah. And I think this is where Harari gets a little controversial because he's talking about religion. It's like the way to get a lot of people on the same ideals and the same boat is to have some sort of storytelling or myths or facts. And he's kind of alluding to religion, saying that's how they were able to control a population, essentially. So that's why I think a lot of people have that issue with this part, because it's saying, well, he's essentially saying religion may or may not be a myth that was created to kind of get everybody on the same page. So that's where I know a lot of controversy comes from, too. But so what do you think of cognitive overall? Like, what was your...
This is my favorite revolution to read through and go through and kind of understand that, because I actually lean more towards on that side of, like, humans started understanding that they needed to come up with... Because he was saying that before the cognitive, literally, they would just sit around and gossip and talk, and that's all they needed to bond. Right. But then once you start gossiping and your tribe gets bigger, your band gets bigger, you start gossiping in a way that like attracts people in, and you start building sides and whose team and on who's what. And that's when they start understanding that like, oh, we have to unite people and how can we unite them? And they start talking about things that commonly bond them. So like for me, he does mention religion here very superficially. He doesn't go into it until we go into agriculture, I believe. Yes, yes. So here, I understand that, because he also mentions later on that religion back in these days really was a local religion. Mm-hmm. It's more about either worshiping the one person or the one thing that they can tangibly see, because again, their cognitive understanding is just what's here and now.
And humans are so spread out. So it's hard to like have the same religion if you're like in Africa versus yes. if you're in the Middle East yeah. and all that.
So
kind
then
of
each
stuff.
Tribe and band had their own religion yep, and their exactly. own belief. And so that I understand, because he didn't really speak about religion in the Almighty God right. or the one universal Allah or anything like that. So that made sense to me.
Yeah. Because he's kind of laying the seed in this. And I felt like during that, the cognitive revolution part, I also really enjoyed this first revolution, because he also talks about money as well. He also introduces money into this.
Okay.
And he talks about how you know, money is the most powerful shared fiction.
Sure is.
Right, and that was pretty cool, because it also was another way to unite a big population together. Because if everyone had a different currency, you know, he kind of about like if you didn't have the same kind of currency or have some sort of concept of money, then it's hard to unite people with just even gossip. You needed yeah. to have extra layers of things to unite a bigger group like that.
I think, to my understanding, the cognitive was the beginning of money, where they mm-hmm. would just yeah. trade within each other. And then once they got to agricultural was when it was more of the universal.
Yeah.
Because that was when they started, yes, traveling yeah. and seeing each other. So that was really cool, because at least for me, when I look at money, I just see it for money as face value. Like I only know it as the value that's been told to me. So mm-hmm. looking and understanding that, like, money doesn't mean anything.
Right.
Like, it's because we decided that it means something that it actually means something. And that was kind of like, wow, like,
yeah,
it's a
human-made concept.
It's this myth that we all believe right. in. It's that bond that creates that connection yes. for all of us.
True.
And
true.
Now it's such a strong bond that it's throughout the entire world. All the currencies are connected in one way or another. There's an exchange rate.
Exactly. And human emotion is connected to it too. If you don't have money, you're sad, you're, you know, depressed.
It's, you it's have kind problems.
Of, right. And yeah. again, it's all human made as well. And
what I liked about this chapter or this portion of the book is when he starts talking about how Homo sapiens came in and started eradicating large animals. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't a coincidence. It wasn't, because there's a lot of arguments for climate change and things like that, that humans didn't do this, mm-hmm. but humans did.
Yes.
They went in and they started killing off all these animals. Mm-hmm. And whether through intimidation, whether through not really understanding the impact of what they were doing, mm-hmm. they did. They went in and just completely killed off more than half of the world's large animals. Right. They did that when they went to Australia. Mm-hmm. And what made it interesting is he talks about that trend is still going, and yes. we are still in this wave now, this third wave that he calls, and says if we don't stop doing something, what we know of like large animals, of sharks and dolphins, and mm-hmm. those are all going to be eradicated yeah. within the next 1,000 years if we don't change the way that we move. And it's true, right? Like our oceans are littered.
Mm-hmm.
We have so many issues with endangered species and ocean life. It's just, it's sad.
It is really sad. And I think with the scientific revolution, we've definitely like catalyzed it a little bit more versus at that time, it was more through hunting and gathering. So it was a little bit slower rate. But now I think with our influence now, we've definitely sped it up.
Our progress.
Significantly.
Yes. This part of the book, I thoroughly enjoyed.
Okay.
I thought it was great. I thought it was fair how he brought up the different theories. I didn't feel, you know, he shared his ideas on things, but I didn't feel like it was necessarily biased or forced upon the readers.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought cognitive revolution, great. So agricultural, this is where we see the Homo sapiens change from foragers to farmers. So mm-hmm. this idea that, you know, before the foragers, they would live day by day, they would spend, you know, X amount of hours going through finding food, come home with their community, cook, spend time together, and then they were not permanently settled, then they would travel and go to another area, find food, and just keep living this like free lifestyle. They didn't have to worry about where the, you know, planting and food and all that, because it was just part of nature. It grew mm-hmm. and they just go find somewhere else to eat. And then while they're somewhere else, then where they just left, it grew back up. And mm-hmm. so it was a constant replenishment that they didn't have to worry about. Once they got the idea that, hey, we can turn things like grains and wheats and potatoes and start cultivating that and have more food without having to go out and search, that gave them this concept of like a permanent settlement and all of that started coming about. They started thinking about the future, thinking, worrying, pondering and planning. And then that's where, you know, we start. It leads up to our everyday culture now, which I thought was interesting. Like why we worry, why we plan when at one time we didn't have to. So it was interesting to see that we brought all of this upon ourselves.
Yeah. And he also talked about how this revolution, the agricultural revolution, was the biggest fraud because we went from this self-sustaining, much more, I guess, present species. Like we were, you know, we were much more with nature. We knew all the signs and stuff. And I think with the farming side of it, we definitely became a much, in his terms, weaker species because we became a lot more just settled into our specific area. We just had to protect our crops. We and we were eating the same stuff versus being so different, eating different things. Because he said, like, you know, other earlier humans, they would gather different berries. They would eat so many different things every single day versus the humans during this revolution. They ate just wheat and other things, and it kind of made them really dependent on this. And so that's why he said it's a big fraud, because it did sort of get rid of the thing that made the humans really special, which was that we were so adaptable to the environment.
If you guys watch our summary, we go through kind of all of the different things that happened with the agricultural revolution. For instance, you know, staying in one local area, they started breeding infectious diseases. Being dependent on potatoes and starches and things like that. Children that were born relied more on grains and oatmeal versus drinking breast milk. So you saw more children mortality, you saw more smaller children. The act of having to cultivate and labor was unusual to foragers because they never sustained back pains and backaches and things like that. And so it started evolving the human body because they were doing things that they biologically weren't ready to do yet, because the ecosystem wasn't ready.
So did you like this part of the
not really?
No. Okay, which part?
I mean, the understanding it was great, but then he also goes into a lot of, I think initially, I don't know why I felt offended, because he essentially were saying we suck as human beings now because back then it was way better. And this is where I kind of got the idea that he's more like, well, it's almost like he's saying progress isn't good, but eventually we have to progress, right? We have to progress. It's we can't stay in the same position forever, because he also does say consistency creates for a dull mind. Like it's natural for us to continually evolve. So I guess I don't really understand his argument. Is he just saying that we evolved too fast, or we shouldn't evolve at all? Because his tone is progress is killing us.
I think his argument was that we evolved too fast because we didn't give ourselves the time to make that proper transition from hunter-gatherer to farmer.
Yeah, but he just says all of these bad things about
being
a farmer, and then all of these great things about being a forager. And it was just so like one-sided. It seemed like it's like it's better if we did this, but then we now have gotten to the point where we can no longer go back from agriculture. Like we can't go backwards, which I understand, but it was just so like this was the perfect life. Almost we had no disease, we had long mortality, long life rates, lifespans, and it was very one-sided for me here, because I was in my mind, progress is important. We needed to progress. And some of the things that we did progress at during that time, it felt to me appropriate.
You know, it's like, I like this revolution a lot. And the reason is because I like the fraud because he does say that it kind of created the first stepping stone into humans becoming so dependent on their environment versus humans being so independent. So like, I think what his main argument was, like, before, humans were very much in control of their lives. They knew exactly what they needed to do. They worked together and they lived day to day. They were more present versus now we're talking about the future. So like, always, hey, we need to get all these things ready for the future. We need to have this much wheat for the next few. I think because of that, a lot of the anxiety, a lot of the stress that maybe humans previously did not have was introduced to us.
Right.
So that's why I liked it a lot, because that is very relative to now as well, where like a lot of us are depressed because we're looking into the future so much. We're trying to get as money as we can, as much money as we can now, and you know, in order to make sure our future is safe, or what he calls
the luxury trap.
Yes, exactly that too. We're like, we're buying new things nonstop, and we're continuously doing it just to kind of stay.
The luxury trap, I think he says, is the idea being obsessed with something that is supposed to make your life easier ends up making your life even harder.
Exactly.
One example is email, right? Mm-hmm. So he says back in the day, when you wrote a letter, it took forever, right? Because you'd have to send it and it had to be delivered. It would take days or weeks or whatever to get a mail. And so you only wrote what was absolutely necessary. Mm-hmm. And then once you sent that letter, you expected, you knew how long it would take to come back. So mm-hmm. it would be an extended amount of time.
Yep.
Now we've got email that's mm-hmm. supposed to decrease the time it takes to send a stamp, submit something. It's just instantaneous. It gets to someone, and that's supposed to save us time. However, mm-hmm. with the creation of that, now we just over communicate about everything that's so not important, things that shouldn't even be in an email. Mm-hmm. How many times have we seen that, right?
Yes.
Like, this should not have, why are you sending this to me? And then with that comes that obligation of a response. You have to respond right away. You have to drop everything that you're doing. There's mm-hmm. this like sense of urgency that's been created when the initial idea was to reduce the amount of time and wait time and all of that, and now we've added something else on.
So yeah, exactly.
Very, very interesting.
And then the other part of this, he in this revolution, he goes over is the large scale political and social system that were made, like the empires that were built starting from this time, mm-hmm. and just how there were hierarchies and there were new religions that came up. Money was a lot more prevalent. You know, eventually we went, he talked about how, you know, before it was measured on how many pounds of wheat you can give each other, but like how inefficient is it to say, I'm going to send you 900 pounds of wheat for one cow, vice versa, versus if we had something that was created to essentially go back and forth with each other.
Yeah.
So I love that, you know, he also did one over that. And I think the part that hit me the most in this one was around the whole hierarchy situation.
Okay. Why is that?
Because, you know, he talked about how the slaves were created, right? Or like why there were slaves. Why was this a hierarchy in terms of the king, and then there's a nobleman, and there's a middleman, all that kind of stuff. And also just some of the stuff against women too, like how women were kind of looked down upon. Mm-hmm. So he goes in, and it's a very sensitive subject to go into.
Yeah.
But he talked about how, like, you know, again, Harari talked about it in this book, but how it was always perceived that, you know, people from Africa were seen as less of a human, 30% mm-hmm. of what a human really is.
Yeah.
And so that's why they were seen as indispensable. You could make them a slave and that's it. And then another thing I also liked a lot was around the female side, the women's side, was that there were always an oppression of women in throughout history. So even though there were different Homo sapiens in North America, South America, Australia, all of the, when they actually surveyed it, all of the women were all oppressed by the men over there.
Yeah.
Where, and he even says, like, you know, why is it that men were the ones in charge of everything, including military, where men are much more aggressive, men are stronger, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, make them the fighter, make them the soldiers. But women should have been the generals, because they're a lot more patient. They're a lot more open-minded.
I will agree with Harari on this one.
Right. So I when I saw that, I was like, huh, that makes a lot of sense. And again, to this day, we're still not there.
Yeah, try telling a man that.
I mean,
that's the problem.
Right. So it was such a cool thing for me to read, because I had never thought of it that way. I didn't know about a lot of that kind of stuff. So that's why I like this book a lot, because it does go back into the historic times, and he is very factual and he's a little blunt at times, but especially with his opinions. But I think that's what made the book even more special for me. But especially this part.
It's respectable.
Part.
Yeah. Definitely.
Especially this part, I know.
He should be very confident in his beliefs and putting that down.
So I like that part a lot around this revolution this was like where I probably spent the most amount of time in my reading. I was like, oh, this is very important for me.
There's a part, I think, in this agricultural, I believe it is, where he mentions how the Asian countries are, he essentially says they weren't as smart and therefore were not, does not have any influence. And that's why European influence is everything that the Asian countries do. I thought it was a bit harsh in a way. And I think that could have been written in a different tone, because that part I thought was very condescending. I didn't appreciate that.
Yeah.
Being Asian myself.
Agree. That was a little a little rough to read, and especially, you know, like I'm from an Indian heritage, and you know, I talk about how, like, you know, the British pretty much took over us for so long, and a lot of other empires have gone through Asian countries like nonstop and changed a lot of their culture as well.
And it's not about being sensitive about it. I think the facts are there.
Right.
Like I do definitely see the European influence and how strong it is and whatnot, but there doesn't need to be that condescending. Literally, I think in there he wrote that like because Asians were lazy or something like that. And I was just like, that tone is not quite right.
Right.
Okay. All right, so then he goes through this third part, which in our summary we don't really cover too deep in details because it kind of is interspersed throughout the summary. Yeah. So talks about how money starts to, at this point, you know, going from the local currency to becoming something that is more universal, that as humans are spreading across the world, it's being exchanged.
Yeah.
More equally than before, goes a lot more openly into religion, and then that goes into the scientific revolution.
Right. So I don't want to go too much into religion for the sake of controversy. So I would love to talk with you about scientific. Though. Okay. That was, it's our most recent one. It's the youngest of all revolutions.
The
500 years, right? It's where we're currently now. But you talk about a lot around how the human curiosity kind of sparked this entire new revolution around science, came to understand our world, our environment more. And of course, the rise of capitalism. And then essentially it goes into that, into money and happiness too. But the spark was definitely going to be around the science part of it.
Yeah. Right?
Humans taking a bigger role in learning about the environment. So what were your thoughts on the science?
I liked how it opened up to why we got to the scientific revolution was that humans realized that we didn't know everything and that there is this ignorance that we do need to acknowledge, because before there was no need to understand or learn anything that didn't affect us. But now there is this progressive need and desire to learn more about something that may not be an urgent need right now. It was more for the discovery and the learning aspect, which they had never crossed.
And that's why I think his tone changes a lot from agriculture to scientific, because it's almost like you said, the humans kind of re-sparked this new adaptation. Like, we need to learn about our environment. We need to make our lives better. We need to progress.
Right.
And we weren't so just dependent and, you know, quote unquote, lazy in the agricultural revolution.
Did you feel like his tone changed in terms of he was happier? I felt like not necessarily happier. I felt like as an author, he wrote the first three parts of the book almost angrily.
Right.
And then he got to the scientific part, which is like, this is what I really wanted to talk about.
Yes, I agree.
And I had to preface everything to finally get here. And then you can finally see more of the flavor and the colorfulness of what really is on his mind here.
Yeah, because he does tie in the other three parts to scientific and talk about like, hey, this is all the stuff happened to us now here.
Yeah.
Here's what's actually happening.
And then this part also launched a second book, right? Or
the
subsequent book.
The next level of humans, right? But I personally also, again, just like the other two revolutions, I like this a lot. And I guess because I do have a science background, this is also very interesting to me about seeing how far we've come.
Yeah.
But the part that I liked probably a lot was around the capitalism part. So you talk about how capitalism has become from an ideology to an entire culture, pretty much. It's taken over the entire world. It was initially started off as just being about money and making sure we have more production to grow. And now it's becoming the underlying theme of our entire life.
Yeah, it's like our ethic. This is how we live.
Yes,
this is how we breathe. Yeah. This is what we're supposed to do. And it controls us in every way.
Yeah, so he does, and you know, especially if you're in America, we are a very capitalistic society, so it is kind of hard to read at times for especially a lot of our Americans.
What made it hard for you?
It made sense, right?
Like, ooh, I feel seen.
Right, yeah. Because you know, kind of going back in my entire life, and it's always been about money.
Everything,
you know, whatever you do, you know, tapas, go to college, become a pharmacist because you can make all this money and you can buy this nice big house, buy a nice car.
You'll be secure for life. You won't have any worries.
And then and you can see like, okay, those seeds were always planted, and it kind of planted in my parents' brain and in my grandparents, all that kind of stuff. It was all there. And now, I mean, you know, we do this and we don't make a lot of money, but
we make no money, guys. But
we found happiness in outside of making only money, yes. Right? So
we are foragers again, once more.
We're going back to foragers, right? Start picking up pennies on the ground.
It's kind of sad. We kind of are foragers, especially during lunchtime, right?
Right. Yes. So that's why I liked it a lot, because it did make me feel a little seen. I was like, oh, it's a very strong presence in our day. Yeah,
it makes you look around and kind of reflect and think, if we know, for the most part, I feel like we all know that money is, you know, the common saying, the root of all evil, right? Mm-hmm. It doesn't buy happiness. Why do we still strive for it mm-hmm. so much? And why do we collectively make it so important? Because that's the problem. We mm-hmm. have now this common belief mm-hmm. that this is what it is, and therefore it's going to be true. If we figure out how to say, no, this isn't what mm-hmm. defines us, and we need to go back to community and get away from this alienation that we have created, then perhaps we can be more in tune with each other and be in the present and enjoy community and enjoy our villages that we have, because and by then we can figure out how to be a little happier.
Right.
But we're just stuck in this mindset.
Yeah. And it's also separated the sapiens from each other a lot more, mm-hmm. right? Our species in general. Because now, you know, and this is during the agricultural revolution. He talked about this, but you know, he talked about how like the Bill of the Declaration of Independence, and you compare it to Hammurabi's law, and Hammurabi's law pretty much says there are going to be rich people, there's middlemen, there's poor people, and that's all it is. And then whereas the Declaration of Independence was supposed to be like, oh, everybody's free, everyone's going to be equal, all that stuff, but then you really realize that's not what it's really like. It was an underlying thing.
And why was it not?
Because to the founding fathers, all men are created equal, right? So you're leaving out women. And you're also not counting in the black.
Anyone
that's not white, right? Yeah. So anyone from other race outside of white is not considered equal, because they're not also, they're considered human or equal men. So that was an underlying thing. And then it's so crazy to me to think about that, but it's so true. Like I thought like, it's still happening to this day. Whereas people saw Hammurabi's law and they're like, this is BS. How could you ever say stuff like that? And they're like, well, if you look at our life, if you look at our reality today, especially now in 2022, it's very prevalent.
Yeah, you said the word reality and made me go back to thinking about how he says that everything that we have now, like we look back to the ancient days and we're like, man, they believed in like spirits and ghosts and voodoo and like all this weird stuff. And now we're so modern and scientific mm-hmm. and so much more real. But what we think is real are actually the same types of ghosts and voodoo stuff. Mm-hmm. It's like things like he talks about the like laws and LLCs and corporations and money. All of these things are ghosts too. Right. It's not real. We just make it. And so imagine like 50 years from now, 200, 2000 years from now, people are going to look back at us and be like, wow, they believed in some really crazy ass shit, because that's not real stuff.
Yes.
But, you know, it's just where it's always hindsight.
It's right? always hindsight. Yeah. This was definitely, and then the last part, he goes into a lot around money and happiness, right? Mm-hmm. He says like, money can never buy you happiness, but it's only seen to make people happy when they come out of poverty.
Yeah.
Right. But the idea of getting more and more money will never lead to happiness.
Yeah. There's actually a good friend of mine was telling me that there's research that there's an actual amount of money mm-hmm. that actually produces happiness. Do you know how much that is? If you make this much a year, you're actually supposed to be happy.
Can I venture a guess?
Yes. What do you think it is?
200K?
It is 70,000K. Mm. 70,000K is supposed to be the sweet spot to bring you happiness.
Wow.
Just enough to survive, not too much to want more. Interesting.
That's very interesting. That's very interesting. And I mean, I believe it. Because it does make sense now, right? Like I think, again, what we do now, we're not making money, but like there's a lot more happiness involved in what we do.
So right now, if we made 70K, I'd be really happy.
Oh, yes, 100%. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Because we're at zero right now. But it's interesting because, you know, our previous jobs, you know, we were making in that ballpark of six figures and never produced that kind of level of happiness that we have now with what we're doing now. So I think that's what he also argues too, is that, you know, the more and more people chase money, the more and more they try to get rich, or stress over money, the less and less likely you'd be happy. And I think that was the underlying tone of the entire book, which, you know, it's funny because one of my friends, when he recommended to me, he's like, oh, this book is about like happiness. And I was like, Sapiens, History of Humankind, Happiness? I don't get it. And then you're like, at the end, you're like, oh, okay, yeah. Got it.
It's like this entire evolutionary chase has been for happiness.
Right.
Like everything that they've done was trying to reach happiness, whether they or not they knew it, that was the goal.
That's true.
Or not. Yeah. So what I did not like about this part is where he blatantly just says, happiness is not based on materialistic anything. It's not materialism. Happiness is solely a biochemical have. Okay, so that's why some people are naturally happier and some people are not naturally happier all the time.
Mm-hmm.
It's biochemical. And so if we can just realize that happiness is biochemical, we can stop focusing on politics and I don't know, whatever else he lists, like a bunch of things that we're doing, and just concentrate all our energy on how to manipulate our biology and our chemistry so that we can be happy. That did not sit well with me.
Okay.
That just felt like we are going into this genetic engineering, this
robotic,
this dystopian type world that I do not feel comfortable yet, because he talks about, oh, we advanced so much and too quickly and that wasn't good. And now he's like, well, all we got to do is just manipulate. And that's like, to me, bypassing all of ecosystem. Like there's no such thing as an ecosystem. Mm-hmm. We create this bubble that we live in and then that's it.
So I thought that was very interesting, the whole biochemistry part. The reason is because he says, you know, how he says like, well, that way you don't have to focus on the political side, money side, right? Yep. So what I got out of it was you have to stop focusing on happiness as an extrinsic factor.
Mm-hmm.
So your environment around you should not give you happiness.
Right.
It should be, it's you within yourself and your own biology. So like dopamine release, all that kind of stuff, that kind of stuff within you and happy thoughts and happy connections in your mind will make you a happy person.
I did not get the tone that it was. So you're saying that this is like more natural, like focus on how to naturally, no.
So he's, what I say, this is why, that's why I liked it a lot, because that's how I took it was, is pretty much saying, I mean, I know he says like the biochemistry and the kind of stuff, but like, I think what he was trying to say was, let's stop focusing on the extrinsic factors outside of yourself to give you happiness and go back to internal and fixing yourself, essentially.
That makes sense. Everyone can see to that.
Yeah. That's what I got out of it. And I know the way he worded it is very blunt and it's like, what? But that's how I look at it. And which is, again, what we talk, our self-help books that we've all talked to in the last.
Yeah.
It's all about internal, making ourselves happy.
Yeah. Towards the end of the book, essentially, he wraps it up and just says, like, look, if we keep going at this rate, we will not survive another 1,000 years. And this will be the end of it.
Yeah.
Even though we have, he brings up all of these different projects and things that are going on right now in the world to preserve life.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently by 2050, there's going to be people who no longer age and they'll just stay at where they're at. And it's really crazy to think about.
Mm-hmm.
But also, I don't know, how does it make you feel ending this book? It's a lot. After you finish reading this book, you like close it and you're like, oh shit.
It gets me, I had two emotions. It gets me nervous.
Yeah.
Or I feel nervous and I feel excited because humans, especially sapiens, evolved, right? And the evolution was so quick. And I think the next evolution of us, which is what he's arguing, the next level of sapien, or maybe even a different species altogether, that is going to be the next, you know, intelligent life out there, a lot more intelligent than us. So like that gets me excited because I would love to say that probably not gonna happen in my lifetime, but you know, that's the next level. That's
you're max intelligent right now.
Huh?
You're max intelligent right now.
as a species, we're max intelligent right now. But it gets me nervous because of what, of how much of a human impact we've made in the entire world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just how much we've destroyed a lot of cool things that we've done. And don't get me wrong, I do appreciate a lot of stuff that humans have done. But a lot of times it kind of me back and saying like, wow, we actually have caused significant harm.
Yeah.
And one thing I think Neil deGrasse Tyson said it, it's like planet Earth will be around forever until it eventually dies. It's we're actually harming ourselves.
Yeah.
We're not harming planet Earth. So you know how they say save the Earth?
Yes.
Earth is not going to save your freaking selves. Yeah. It's us that's going to be affected. So I wish there was more that could be done, but at the same time, I'm kind of excited for next level. Or next version. Well,
I think that's innate, right? Like progress and growth, I think is something that should happen. Mm-hmm. But again, it goes back to at what rate and for what purpose.
Yeah.
Because I think progress for advancement of us for efficiency, happiness is important, but for curiosity's sake, for greed, for money, for political agendas, things like that, that's where we need to figure out and how we can put the brakes on that, because that's only going to harm us.
Yeah.
Okay, so two things from this chapter that I really took away was when he talks about the atomic bomb. Mm. So this is when he says, out of the scientific revolution, one of the greatest things is the creation of the atomic bomb. And that's significant because this has the ability to end humankind altogether, and never before has that happened, right? So we now have in our possession something that can obliterate everyone. So that was kind of like, whoa, like you know it, but just putting it in that context, that was pretty significant. Like that gave me chills to
Imagine from that was about 50 years ago almost, pardon my ignorance, but atomic bomb was created about 56 years ago, and now where we're at, the technology, like we've even made that power even stronger, right? Mm-hmm. Like that is scary in itself, and it's crazy that humans have built this world, and we essentially could destroy it ourselves, our entire species with one.
Yeah. Well, I will say that for me, closing this book really made me reflect on my own life. And there are things that I see around us in the world that does give me hope. I feel like the recent events starting 2019 that took over the world and made everyone stay home and more cautious and social distancing, that really has given a lot of people perspective and made them reflect on what's really important. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what gave way to the Great Resignation. And there's more people now standing up for what they want to prioritize as their own happiness. So I think that is a great step in towards humanity and saving humanity. So I hope that, you know, what we do can influence and help others realize that, hey, what Harari says, you are correct in that you have to figure out intrinsically how you can make yourself happy. Mm-hmm. Looking outwards, chasing money, doing all of these things, it's only going to harm you if you don't realize how much it's costing you
right
at the same time. So it gives me peace to know that when we left our six-figure job and the safety and security of that financial net that we had, it was scary, right? Mm-hmm. But now, like, every freaking day has been happy, and we have, you know, we recently some opportunities, great opportunities that have been presented to us for in the upcoming month, and so we're really excited about that. Mm-hmm. But it just goes to show that when you can be happy, you can prioritize your own happiness, you can spread that happiness to others around you, and then that goodness just circulates around the world, and it has allowed us to network and meet great people that we otherwise wouldn't have, right? Mm-hmm. So now the opportunities that are coming to us are so much more fruitful than what we've had before,
right?
Financially, potentially more, right? So it's just really it was a good feeling to say, hey, at least for humanity, if we're going to die in 1,000 years, like, how do we now reflect inward and say we need to make a change? Because I think if we start a revolution, another revolution in where we actually stand up as humans to say, let's take back happiness and let's prioritize what's good for us, then it might shift.
Yeah, and I think it's already beginning to happen, because you're starting to see, like you said, the great resignation. People are prioritizing happiness and self-development, self-growth over money and materialistic things, right? Yeah. So like, I think it's amazing to see that there's a movement being led, especially with the younger generation. So, you know, again, we'll see where this lands. We'll I think recent events may even make Harari very proud, because a lot of people are prioritizing their self-happiness. And again, going back to biochemistry within themselves, making themselves happy.
Not biochemistry, engineering.
Bioengineering, that's right. Overall, I enjoy this book a lot.
I liked it.
Yes. It's definitely a very long read, guys. But again, it is a very fun book.
And if it is very long, then may we introduce you to the graphic novel version? Mm-hmm. It is a picture book, and the content is just as great. Mm-hmm. I've read on the reviews, a lot of people have read this with their high school students, kids, things like that, and it hits a little bit differently if reading text is a little bit harder. So definitely recommend that. And we've got links right below for you guys. If you didn't understand what we said, please check out our summary. That's much more clear.
Yes.
Thank you for joining Eat, Read, Sleep this week for Sapiens, where we debated tapas for Kalina.
Sort of again.
Sort of cool con. Sure. But at least we can walk away saying, let's control our intrinsic happiness and get through what we live in together and do it through vibing with books.
All right. Thanks, guys. Bye.
Bye, guys.